knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
For the past few tutorials, we have been examining cycloaddition reactions, such as the Diels-Alder reaction. These involve the formation of six-membered rings, or five-membered rings in the case of 1,3 dipolar cycloadditions. In both cases, the reaction occurs in a single concerted step, forming two new sigma bonds at the expense of pi bonds. But cycloaddition reactions are only one subclass of all the various pericyclic reactions, so let's check out another subclass called sigmatropic shifts. Sigmatropic shifts differ from cycloadditions in that it is a sigma bond that is broken, which will reform at some distance from where it was initially. These reactions, which tend to occur at elevated temperatures, are also subject to the 4N plus 2 rule that dictates which cycloadditions are possible, so let's see some examples to better understand this. First we have 1,5-hexadiene. When heated, cyclization of these two pi bonds and this sigma bond can occur to produce what is still the same compound, but we can see that the connectivity of the atoms has shuffled. These two carbons, marked with an asterisk, will help us see that this is not simply a rotated view of the original structure. This reaction is an example of a 3-3 shift. This numbering can be understood if we treat the molecule as two fragments and number the two carbons participating in the sigma bond as carbon 1 of each of the two fragments, continuing to number across to get carbons 2 and 3. As we can see, the sigma bond between carbon 1 and carbon 1 is broken, and the new sigma bond is between carbon 3 and carbon 3. That's why this is called a 3-3 shift. Once again, the number of electrons involved in the cyclization is 6, 4 pi and 2 sigma, which is why this reaction is allowed, as the transition state can be thought of as aromatic in character and therefore stabilized. To get a sense of what is not permitted in this context, take a look at an example of what would be considered a 1-3 shift. This would essentially entail the migration of this alkyl group over to the other terminal carbon in this allylic system, with 2 sigma and 2 pi electrons involved in the shift. Numbering the alkyl group 1 and then 1 through 3 for the other fragment, we can see how it would be numbered this way. But 4 is an anti-aromatic number, so this is not a favorable process, and indeed, a shift of this kind is rarely observed. Returning to the 3-3 example, this simplest system here can be said to be degenerate. That is to say, the product is the same as the starting material, and can only be differentiated if we were to incorporate isotopic labeling, such as if the asterisks we used earlier implied carbon-13 nuclides. Because this system is degenerate, we can expect a one-to-one mixture, with chair-like transition states as it shifts from one form to the other. We can begin to see a discrepancy in the two structures by adding substituents. For example, let's put a phenyl group on this terminal carbon. If the shift were to occur, the phenyl group would be on an internal carbon, so these structures are no longer the same. They are also not of the same energy, because we can see that in the first structure, one of the pi bonds is conjugated with the phenyl group, whereas in the other, it is not. So this is where we can begin to see the equilibrium shift more towards one structure over the other. These examples we have just examined can also be referred to as the Cope rearrangement. These usually require temperatures of around 200 degrees Celsius to proceed. One may question the synthetic utility of this technique, as even when an equilibrium prefers one form over another, there is still the disadvantage of low yield and the necessity of separating from starting material. But organic chemists have come up with clever tricks to enhance the utility of the technique. One approach is to generate some starting material that is dramatically more unstable than the product of the sigmatropic shift, and one way to do this is to incorporate ring strain. For example, consider this structure with a cyclopropane ring. In carrying out the reaction, the three-membered ring is cleaved and a seven-membered ring is formed. The difference in stability is so extreme that we can consider this to be essentially unidirectional. Similarly, instead of destabilizing the reactant, we can also stabilize the product. Take this substrate, for example, with a hydroxyl in this position. If the shift is carried out, an enol will result, which, as we know, will rapidly tautomerize to give the carbonyl, in this case, an aldehyde. Here, bond enthalpies are responsible for the stability of the product, with the carbon-oxygen double bond being especially strong. This modification of the Cope rearrangement is called the Oxy-Cope rearrangement. Now, if we combine these approaches, both destabilizing the starting material and stabilizing the product, the reaction becomes favorable enough to occur even at room temperature. Consider the same starting material as the previous example, but with an oxyanion instead of a hydroxyl. This is unstable, as the anion is localized on the oxygen. After the shift, the anion is resonance stabilized. We would call this the anionic oxy-cope rearrangement, and this technique is prevalent in synthesis. To see an example of its application, consider this substituted cyclobutanone. Treatment with a vinyl Grignard reagent will produce this magnesium alkoxide intermediate, which we can quickly see is capable of a 3-3 sigmatropic shift via oxy-cope rearrangement. Breaking this sigma bond has the ramification of cleaving the 4-membered ring and producing an 8-membered ring, and acidic workup will produce the enol, which will tautomerize to give the ketone. And that leaves us with this cyclooctenone, the product of ring expansion through the oxy-cope rearrangement. Let's make one more modification on the Cope rearrangement. We can replace one of the carbon atoms with an oxygen atom, perhaps on carbon 3, to give this ether. Now let's allow the 3-3 shift to take place, and as we can see, we are left with an aldehyde. As we might imagine, bond enthalpies dictate that this equilibrium will lie heavily to the right, favoring the stable carbonyl. This variation is called the Claisen rearrangement, and it is a great way to synthesize gamma-delta unsaturated carbonyl compounds, where we are counting up the Greek alphabet from the carbonyl carbon, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, with the other pi bond in the product sitting between the gamma and delta positions. For Claisen rearrangements where substituents are present, given the chair-like transition state, substituents will prefer to occupy pseudo-equatorial positions rather than pseudo-axial, and the olefin products will tend to form with E configuration rather than Z. The interesting thing about this rearrangement is that the driving force of carbonyl formation is even enough to momentarily destroy aromaticity. Consider this starting material. Upon heating, the 3-3 shift will take place, despite the fact that it requires breaking the aromaticity of this benzene ring. The reason this is possible is that tautomerization can then take place to yield the enol, which is the opposite direction we are used to seeing tautomerization proceed, but in this case, it is driven by the fact that enol formation restores aromaticity for the benzene ring. So phenyl ethers and vinyl ethers are great candidates for Claisen rearrangement. Before moving on, we should mention that it is not just 3-3 shifts that are possible. Other types can happen as well, though they are not as synthetically useful. One example is the 1-5 hydride shift. This still involves 4 pi and 2 sigma electrons, but we are seeing a hydride shift from one carbon to another one 4 carbons away. The pi bonds shuffle around and we are left with this, with the equilibrium heavily favoring the product due to the conjugation of the phenyl ring with the other pi bonds. And that covers an introduction to sigmatropic shifts.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.